Story of the birth of Jesus. The time came for her to have her child, and the God baby was born in a stable. The gospel made no mention of animals, but they must have been there. And one of the wonderful things about the nativity is that it was the kind of things that even livestock could experience. Because the Christmas story is not just some feel-good fairy tale about peace, love, and hope. It is about a real thing that really happened, a visible event in history. The Son of God really became a baby boy who really was born in a stable in Bethlehem a little more than 2,000 years ago, and his mother really wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Things can start to sound fantastical. When the visitors arrive, the humble shepherd, led by an army of angels, the mysterious magi, guided by a singular star, and the whole Christmas story is becoming so familiar, the scenes so gussy and gluing in our imagination, that it all begins to feel a bit remote, romantic, even unreal. But the animals help ground us. There is nothing romantic or fantastic about them. They were just normal animals doing normal things like eating, drinking, hopping, and unwittingly witnessing one of the greatest moments in the history of the world. And how about those shepherds who had been out in the field keeping the night over their flock? As the Gospel of Luke tells us, when angels appeared to them to announce that a Savior had been born, they were terrified. But they went in haste and found Mary and Joseph and the infant laying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known the message that had been told them about this child. All who heard were amazed by what had been told them by the shepherds. We are in much the same position as the shepherds. We have heard the good news. And now the question is, what will we do with it? The shepherds left all they had to worship the newborn Lord. They risked humiliation by sharing the strange message with others. Will we? We do have the courage to live like the shepherds.
In a place where midnight skies were clear, so long ago, so far, that little towns would lay so still beneath the silent stars. A world so different from our own, where the Son of God was born, the light and life of every soul, wherever we are. If we seek the light, when peace is hard to find, He'll send us silent nights and touch our ears so we can hear an angel voice. And in the darkest times, He will lift our eyes to see the stars still shine. Now the lights we hang obscure the sky, the clamor steals the song. We miss the calm and quiet nights, filled with wondering awe. And all the while the risen Lord freely gives us so much more, the peace on earth we're looking for has been here all along. If we seek the light when peace is hard to find, He'll send us silent nights and touch our ears so we can hear an angel voice. And in the darkest times, He will lift our eyes to see the stars still shine. To see the star still shines.
Como el calendario litúrgico deja claro inmediatamente, el anuncio del Evangelio a menudo se encuentra con oposición. Al día siguiente de celebrar el nacimiento de Jesús, La iglesia marca la muerte de San Esteban, la primera persona que es martirizada por su fe en Cristo. Su muerte por lapidación está registrada en los Hechos de los Apóstoles. Al día siguiente, 27 de diciembre, es la fiesta de San Juan, que según la tradición fue el único de los 12 apóstoles que no fue martirizado, simplemente sumergido en aceite hirviendo y exiliado. El Evangelio de Juan es una gran lectura para la época navideña. A pesar de que no escribió ninguna narrativa en la infancia, en cambio, Juan iluminó el significado del nacimiento de Jesús, poniendo en palabras el hecho incomprensible de la encarnación. Su evangelio comienza famosamente: al principio era la palabra, y la palabra estaba con Dios, y la palabra era Dios. Y el verbo se hizo carne e hizo su morada entre nosotros. Hay suficiente sustancia y misterio en estas pocas palabras para toda una vida de oración y reflexión.
You never change. You are the God you say you are. When I'm afraid, you come and steal my beating heart. You stay the same. When hope is just a distant thought, you take my pain and you lead me to the cross. What love is this that you gave your life for me and made a way for me to know you? And I confess, you are always enough for me. You're all I need. I look to you. I see the scars upon your hands and hold the truth that when I can't, you always can. And standing here beneath the shadow of the cross, I'm overwhelmed that I keep finding open arms. What love is this that you gave your life for me and made a way for me? Jesus, sing.
As we finish this year, Christmas season, we celebrated the Holy Family of Jesus, Mary and Joseph, whose experience should put to rest the popular prosperity gospel message that if you try to follow God's will, things will go well for you in this world. Never did a group of people more perfectly follow God, and yet, even for this most holy family, things rarely go well. They got off to a rough start when Mary turned up pregnant with a child that was not Joseph. A crisis averted only by angelic intervention. 9 months later, Mary had to give birth to a born. Then, an evil king plotted to murder the baby Jesus, forcing the family to flee the country. The only other episode from Jesus' childhood recorded in the Gospels involved Mary and Joseph panicking after they lost him for the better part of a week. Joseph died while Mary was still young. And then Mary had to watch as her only son was tortured and injured, executed in the most brutal, humiliating way imaginable. No, things were never easy for the Holy Family. That is because holiness has nothing to do with an easy life, except perhaps to humiliate against it. If we are truly starving to follow God, we should be prepared to face tough decisions, difficult circumstances, mockery, persecution, and even death. If the Holy Family could not escape such trial, why should we? That may seem like a rather gloomy way to wrap up a reflection of the Nativity, but the season of Advent and Christmas remind us that the suffering of this world, even death itself, no longer have the last word. For in the birth of Jesus, God has invaded our world, and by his life, death, and resurrection, he has opened for us the gate of heaven and purchased for us the reward of eternal life. On Christmas night, the cry of the Christ child heralds the promise for we will fulfill on Easter morning. In the world, you will have trouble, but take courage. I have conquered the world.
journeyed far, a weary bear. They sought for shelter from the cold night air, some place where she could lay her head, where she could give her babe a quiet bed. Was there no room, no corner there, in all the town a spot someone could spare? Was there no soul come to their aid? A stable bed was where the family stayed. Do you have room for the Savior? And do you seek Him anew? Have you a place for the one who lived and died for you? Are you as humble as a shepherd boy, or as wise as men of old? Would you have come that night? Would you have sought the light? Do you have room? A star arose, a wondrous light, a sign from God. This was the holy night, and yet so few would go to see the babe who came to rescue you and me. This child divine is now a king, the gift of life to all the world he brings, and all mankind he saves from doom. But on that night for him there was no room. Do you have room for the Savior? And do you seek Him anew? Have you a place for the one who lived and died for you? Are you as humble as a shepherd boy, or as wise as men of old? Would you have come that night? Would you have sought the light? Do you have room? Will you come tonight? Will you seek the light?
con la celebración del bautismo del Señor, daremos fin al tiempo de la Navidad. Entraremos en el tiempo ordinario de la Iglesia. El bautismo del Señor y la entrada al tiempo ordinario nos invitan a mirar hacia atrás por un momento al tiempo de la Navidad y a reflexionar cómo la hemos celebrado. Quizás preguntarnos qué significado especial ha tenido para nosotros en este tiempo la Navidad. Quizás nos ayuden a mirar las lecturas de ese tiempo. Lecturas que están salpicadas de momentos de incertidumbre, de miedo, de dolor, de muerte. Parece extraño que un evento tan importante y que nosotros buscamos celebrar con alegría tenga aspectos negativos. ¿Qué nos dice esto? ¿Cómo nos ayuda esto a cerrar la Navidad y caminar hacia adelante? Posiblemente la pregunta que debiéramos hacernos es, ¿y ahora qué? Hay dos historias que escuchamos durante el tiempo de la Navidad que nos pueden dar una idea de cómo movernos hacia adelante. La primera es la historia de los inocentes que mueren a manos de Herodes. Mientras que la Navidad nos recuerda que Dios vive en el mundo, que viene al mundo para estar con nosotros, y así le llamamos Emmanuel, Dios con nosotros, la historia de Herodes nos enseña lo que es capaz de hacer una persona cuando se siente intimidada o amenazada por la luz, por la esperanza y el amor que trae el Dios con nosotros. Esa persona es capaz de herir y matar para callar o eliminar al Dios con nosotros. Podemos decir que la mejor manera de contestar la pregunta ¿y ahora qué? Es estar conscientes de que siempre estaremos rodeados de cosas, situaciones, personas que quieren callar al Dios con nosotros, que quieren eliminar aquello que trae esperanza, alegría, luz y la oportunidad de seguir conociendo y estar en unión con Jesús. Nuestra responsabilidad es evitar estas cosas, situaciones o personas. Recordar que no todo fue fácil para la Sagrada Familia y no lo será para nosotros. Nuestra responsabilidad es no ser nosotros las personas, agentes que puedan callar la esperanza que Dios trae para todos. Un detalle de la Sagrada Familia es que se mantuvieron fieles a Dios. Nuestra responsabilidad es dejar que lo que comenzó en la Navidad se siga desarrollando en cada uno de nosotros. No ser nosotros nuestros propios obstáculos para evitar el desarrollo de la alegría de la Navidad y no ser obstáculos para que otros puedan desarrollar lo que experimentaron con el Dios que se hace carne y que trae luz al mundo. La segunda historia es la de José y María cuando traen a Jesús al templo para cumplir lo que estaba prescrito en la ley. Luego de escuchar lo que Simeón y Ana dijeron del niño, regresaron a su casa donde Jesús creció en sabiduría y la gracia de Dios estaba sobre él. ¿Qué aprendió Jesús en esa familia que lo ayudó a crecer en sabiduría? Cuando vemos la historia de Jesús, entendemos que se desarrolló en un ambiente donde creció en humildad, generosidad, compasión y en paciencia. Dejar que lo que comenzó en la Navidad se desarrolle en nosotros es crecer en sabiduría y en la gracia de Dios. Nuestra responsabilidad es la de no olvidarnos de que Dios está con nosotros. Nuestra responsabilidad es la de seguir conociendo a Jesús y aprender de Él. Es la de abrir los ojos y el corazón como lo hicieron Simeón y Ana, para estar consciente de la presencia de Dios en nuestra vida, en nuestro mundo, en nuestras familias, en nuestro diario quehacer. ¿Y cómo se manifiesta en nosotros? Es de tomar pasos concretos que nos ayuden a crecer en fidelidad a Dios. Caminar con esperanza, aun cuando no entendemos, no sepamos, no tengamos las cosas claras, es caminar con Dios. Es estar abierto a las sorpresas que Él tiene para nosotros.
God's own Son, who set the worlds in motion, who filled the deepest oceans and lit the starry skies, came as man to share our mortal weakness, to make himself in meekness his creation sacrifice, to show us love beyond all love, to wash away my sins, to live and die that such as I might live. His kindness stills my aching, my shattered heart remaking from the ashes of despair. When justice claims my soul, His tender mercy intercedes, redeems the lost and pays the cost for me. How can I do anything? porque fue varón justo, le amó el Señor, y dice el cielo por uno su labor. El alba mensajero del sol de la brillo, conoce ese martillo que suena en la madera, la mano carpintera madruga su quehacer, y acrece antes que el sol en el porque fue varón justo, le amó el Señor, y diciendo por uno su labor. Cabeza de tu casa, del que el Señor se fija, por la carpintería la gloria entera pasa. Tu mano se acompasa con Dios en la labor, y alarga su la mano que fue varón justo, le amó el Señor, y Dios siento por uno su labor. Y pues es mundo entero te nace pregunta a ti, de tú cómo se junta ser santo carpintero, la gloria y el madero, la gracia y el afán. Dios es casual pan, porque fue varón.